Live from Hollywood, California, welcome to another edition of Actors E-Chat. I'm Kurt Kelly, and today we have someone who comes from the... Well, thank you. Hey, it's me! We have someone who comes from the South, the Deep South. In fact, where they make bourbon. But that's a whole other story. And he's a singer, he's a composer, a songwriter, and also an actor. And welcome to Hollywood, Michael Grant.
Yay! How are
you? You knew you came from the land of bourbon, right?
Yeah.
Jack Daniels.
Yeah,
that stuff. Yeah. So what got you inspired from the hills of Tennessee to get into entertainment?
You know, it's an interesting thing, man. I started off doing classical piano, actually, when I was 4 years old.
That's a little early.
It's a little early. But one day I told my mom, you know, she'd had me in some classes, you know, where you clap to the beat and say one, two, three, that kind of thing. You know, I said, I think I want to try to play piano. And she was like, all right.
Sure. This is at age four.
Yeah, age four. Yeah.
You were an early starter also. I like that.
Yeah.
So did you have a piano in the house or when did you see the first piano and go, this is what I'm doing?
Yeah, I don't know, man. I don't think we had one in the house.
So you didn't come from a musical family? Mom and dad weren't in a band?
No, my mom and dad are both doctors, actually.
What?
Yeah, I know. It's crazy.
Whole different gene pool you came from in the family tree. Is anyone in the family in entertainment?
No, not at all.
So you decided to blaze a new path.
I guess so,
Do you play to ear, or do you have to re-cheat music?
I mean, I can play by ear, but I've, you know, grown up playing classically and learning to read sheet music. That was a big part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's actually one of the main ways I kind of got into it. And, you know, one thing led to another, and I was doing piano lessons at a university, and I started taking improv classes and, you know.
From there,
yeah,
more.
Yeah,
more
from there,
developed.
More. And then, you know, wound up meeting with a local talent agent who was like, you know, you ought to give LA a shot. You know, I think you know, you're pretty good. You could do well out there. And parents, I'm really fortunate, you know, to have good ones because they were super supportive. And, you know,
we came out.
And yeah, really good.
So, how many siblings do you have in your family, or are you the only brother?
No, I have one sister.
Okay.
Yeah, she's awesome. She's 13.
And is she following in the footsteps?
Yeah, she was actually kind of before me a little bit. She was almost, you know, when I was doing the piano, she was kind of doing the singing and the acting. And
oh, nice.
Yeah. So she's super talented, really smart. I love her. She's like
so
my best friend.
So at some point, will we be seeing the two of you appear together in a television, a film, or a concert?
Yeah, very possible.
That is possible?
Yeah,
okay.
For sure.
So when was your first performance, whether it was on stage or it sounds like it was with the piano somewhere?
Yeah. I want to say like three or four, maybe I was five, I don't know.
Wow.
Yeah, but so the story goes, as I've been told after the fact, because I don't really remember it too well. I got up and I started playing Twinkle Little Star.
You don't remember very well? You're not that old. Come on. Back in the old days. Yes.
Yeah. Anyway.
Yes, Twinkle.
Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. And, I did the whole thing, Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, the whole thing. And everyone got up and clapped, you know, yay, good job, the kid, you know.
Right.
He can breathe and move his fingers a little bit. And I went back. I was so enthusiastic about the response that I went back and I played it again from start to finish.
Wow.
Because I thought they just wanted to hear more and that was what I knew, so I went up and I just did it again.
So you were an entertainer from the very beginning then.
Yeah.
Now you actually go on into a studio to work on an album and do composing and performing, or has it been more of a on-stage concert type performance?
Yeah, I've been in the studio some. I've written some things, and I don't have any kind of full-length album in the works, but it's just something kind of for me that I love to do and really enjoy doing and have a lot of fun with.
Since it is a passion, I know there's a video or two that we have of you performing, doing music. Is this something that you're going to actually be performing and working towards? This is you doing a performance of which song?
This is Yellow by Coldplay,
mm-hmm.
One of my favorite bands in the world, one of my favorite songs. And it's kind of fun. What I did in the computer with Logic, which is a software system,
You're an Apple guy.
Yeah, Apple guy. I laid the tracks down, and I did everything from the keyboard you see right there.
Nice.
And, you know,
So you're a one-man show.
Yeah, I guess so.
Interesting. Yeah. Now, you can also, for people who want to see that, could go to your website and see some of your musical performances?
Yeah, for sure. And it's on YouTube as well, Michael Grant Yellow. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when was your first performance in getting into television, film, and commercials? Because you've also done a lot of commercials.
I've done a few of those.
What was first, the commercials, television, or film?
Actually, it was probably the television. I did a little guest spot on a Disney Channel show called Shake It Up.
Most people would give their childhood dreams to do that, and you started your first show as a Disney Network show. How did that happen?
Just auditioning, honestly.
Really?
Just getting in the room and, you know, hearing a lot of no's before you hear that yes, and just staying persistent at it, honestly.
Now, was the audition for Shake It Up, this television series with those two lovely women?
Yes,
was
that
two. Who are they, by the way?
Bella Thorne is one of the girls,
right.
And Zendaya. I think she just goes by Zendaya, actually.
Zendaya.
Yeah.
And Zendaya's the one on the right, I'm
guessing? Yeah, Zendaya's the one on the right.
See, I'm guessing well.
There
today.
You go.
And so, was this shot here in Los Angeles, or where did you do the auditions for this?
I did the auditions. The auditions were held in the same vicinity as the same studio, same soundstage as the where they shot the show, which was downtown L.A.
Right.
With all the big buildings and, you know, where all the highways down by Staples Center,
mm-hmm.
Which was a lot of fun. And it was really cool. You know, they'd actually originally written my role because I was one of the many boyfriends that have been on that show for those girls. You know, there's like, there's...
How does it feel being one of many?
I mean, good. I was in the beginning, you know, so...
Right.
They actually originally wanted it to be twins.
Uh-huh.
It was supposed to be like, and they were like twins there at the audition, I remember.
Real twins?
Yeah, real twins,
okay.
Who like looked identical. That was supposed to be like the joke, like these two girls go out and like these two guys and they're twins, and you know, that was one
guess
of the
jokes. Guess who you're really dating tonight.
Yeah, I guess who you're, yeah, like, you know.
So when you first auditioned, were you hoping for it to be a recurring role, or you would just be happy if you could get a shot on the show?
I mean, honestly, I was just happy to be able to be on there and be on set and have, like, a dressing room and, you know, the whole thing. And
how old were you when that first show took off for you?
I was 15, I think.
So that was last week. No, I'm kidding. So what was the next show you did after that show for Disney? Because you've done several shows for ABC, what I understand,
which
is the Disney Corporation.
Yeah, I did a, after that I did a... did a guest spot on Private Practice, which mm-hmm. was awesome. I actually got to play a classical pianist with a brain tumor on that. It's a funny story about that. I had to learn a Chopin nocturne in 4 days to play on stage live on camera for the show.
So this wasn't dubbed in or looped. You were actually performing live.
Yeah, I was playing that. And there's Private Practice.
For television and film, for people who don't know, a lot of times the background players are all looped in through ADR later, or voice looping. And so is a lot of the music. But this one, they actually said, we're miking this piano, this is live?
How
did that feel, knowing that pressure was on?
It was fun. You know, it was a lot of fun. We, the director was actually one of the actors on the show, for anyone who watched the show, Dr. Cooper, Paul Adelstein. He was awesome. He was super supportive. He's like, look, as many takes as you need.
Oh, nice.
But not to brag or anything, I only needed a couple. So.
Really?
Yeah.
So you were like one of these one-take wonders. Okay, we'll get the backup take in case a key was off or something.
Yeah.
We have a question from one of our e-chatters. Pepper J, what's the question this morning?
The question is what actors were you able to work with on Private Practice? And this is
one of the actor directors, Paul, that you were talking about.
Yeah, Paul, he was awesome, man. He was it was actually his first time directing on the show, and he was awesome. We had a bunch of scenes together, and he was just so great and supportive.
There were a lot of great people on that show. Who else did you have the pleasure of working with?
See, I worked with the brain surgeon.
Mm-hmm.
The brain surgeon. She was awesome. And they were so great, you know.
How did it feel? You know, the piano part probably came easily, but having to get into the role and mindset of here's someone who's with an affliction of a brain tumor, that's not necessarily the easiest role to jump into.
Yeah, completely. It was something I auditioned with, and both the parents actually died in a car accident.
So this was based on a true story. Or the storyline?
Yeah, not to my not to my knowledge that it was based on a true story. But both my parents had died in a car accident, and I lived with my grandfather. The story was, you know, the way I connected to him was through the piano, through classical music because he was also, he had done that. That was the story, you know, in the episode. So it was a great role, you know, a lot of great scenes that I got to do on there, and just a blast to work with those guys.
Fabulous. We'll be back with more of Michael Grant's true story in a moment. You're watching Actors E-Chat live from Hollywood. I'm Kirk Kelly.
The great thing about NNOW Media is the one-stop shop. We are soup to nuts. We have writers, directors, producers, animators, motion graphics artists, editors, videographers, musicians, all under one roof. And we are a boutique creative house where we actually do the creative at much more affordable price and have the staff in-house to execute it professionally. My name is John Palacio.
My name is Luz Montez.
My name is Paul Robinson.
I am Jesse Cervantes.
I'm Curtis Peel.
My name is Ben Joran.
One of the most common questions we have from potential clients is, how does it work? What happens when you engage NNOW Media to create a video, a marketing campaign?
It first starts with, you know, obviously having the phone conversation with the client, brainstorm with them to come up with a really good concept and a really good idea to push whatever they're trying to do to the next level.
Only with that in mind can we really try to tailor a concept and a script for their exact audience that fits in with their branding and the message they want to tell.
I will storyboard it out, get a real rough idea of what we want to do.
We'll then present the client with a couple of options, different ways that we could go with some of the things that we've come up with.
And they'll say, this is good, and then we'll come back and we'll start animating that or designing it or editing it.
Our clients are generally, you know, like to be really hands-on, and we'd like to hear from you kind of all along the board. There's no surprises.
What we like to do with every partner is we actually create a page on the NNOW website.
So they can give feedback, and that way, when the time we get to the final product, you know, usually there's not a whole lot more revisions to do because we've already been working together the whole time.
The big difference is that real personal creative touch.
We have a creative group that can execute that vision, whether it's animation, video, motion graphics, and do so with some unique creative that is custom tailored to that business.
You know, dream it up. It's video. It's magic. It can happen.
Live from Hollywood, you're watching Actors E-Chat. I'm Kurt Kelly. Don't forget to go to our sister site, Actors Reporter. Click on the Actors Discount link, which will take you to all the people who have been supporting the show over the last five, almost 6 years now, with over 1,000 guests. And they help give you special discounts because when you go to the site and type in Actors Reporter discount code, it'll give you special discounts on their services. We'd like to thank them for being so supportive. And Michael Grant, you got to tell me about your lying experience.
You mean Pretty Little Liars?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, yeah,
well,
yeah.
That was part of a lying experience.
I guess
it?
So. They call them the liars from what I hear on the promos. Yeah, I had a really cool role on Pretty Little Liars on ABC Family. Got to work with a bunch of cool people, the beautiful Lucy Hale, who was awesome. We actually shared a moment.
Okay. I'm glad you clarified the moment.
Yeah, she's the one. Let's see. She's the one second from the left.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
With the big blue eye.
Yeah.
Yes.
But yeah.
To remember.
But it was great. I got to work on that show with a bunch of awesome people. There was some cool mystery around my character. My car got smashed and painted with liar because I kind of was a little bit of a forceful in my asking out of Lucy Hale's character, Aria, on the show, which didn't work out so well for me, and my car, which got smashed in the episode.
Now, over the years, I've worked at ABC.
Oh, awesome.
And I knew what it was like when I worked there.
Yeah.
And then Disney, well, Cap Cities came in and it changed a lot, and then Disney came in and changed even more.
Right.
But I hear that now under the Disney umbrella, as it's evolved more, that they're pretty strict on standards for the Family Channel and some of these shows. How is that imposed upon you as an actor about your public image, even when you're off the set?
You mean in terms of like no bad behavior, basically?
Yeah. The turpitude clause that they put into everybody's contract.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean,
don't do that.
Yeah, don't do that. Well, I mean, it's just not getting in bad situations, basically. you know, I was a series regular on Secret Life of the American Teenager on ABC Family.
Did that change how you were in public, or were you just naturally who you are and it didn't change at all?
It didn't change much, although I did get recognized a bunch in Disneyland.
Really?
Yeah, which
nice.
Was fun. It was surprising, actually. I wasn't, kind of came out of nowhere. I wasn't expecting it at all. You know, a bunch of...
Getting stopped by the Magic Castle, and here, let me sign an autograph because I'm an American teenager.
Yeah, it was actually...
Who's that you're with?
Yeah, that's... I was the guy on the right. Ricky was the character's name, Darren Kagasoff, an awesome guy. Mm-hmm. I was his foster brother.
I see.
In the show, yeah. So.
Now, you've played some roles where you also are kind of like the troubled son or the troubled brother or the troubled friend. How do you get into these troubled roles? Because you don't seem like a troubled person.
No. I don't think I am. Anyway.
Okay.
Maybe I just haven't discovered that yet.
The other side of me.
Yeah, the other side. But no, in terms of the troubled stuff, it's a lot of stuff is there in the script already.
Right.
It's just about kind of internalizing it and saying, okay, this guy's going through, you know, this thing. You know, he's like on Secret Life, the character was, you know, stealing knives and getting in some trouble and mischief. And it's basically, as the actor, I just say, okay, so I haven't stolen any knives in my life, but, you know, what things have I done, and, you know.
And who do I know who's been a knife stealer?
Yeah, I can kind of pull from.
We have another question from one of our e-chatters. Pepper, what's the question?
Yes, Michael, we have a question from North Dakota.
Oh, sweet.
And they would like to know, so what is it like to be recognized?
What's it like to be recognized?
Nice question.
It's cool. You know, for me, I'm just... when people come up and they say they're fans of the show, it just makes me really happy, you know, because I put, you know, not just me, but the whole crew and cast, you know, everyone puts in so much work getting there at all hours of the day and night and working hard. And when people really like it and you know, get some enjoyment or message or just, you know, have fun watching the show, it makes it worth it in some ways, you know.
Since you started, we have another question from
a
new chatter.
Yes, we do. So another chatter wants to know, any audition hints?
Audition hints.
Good question.
Yeah. And I've had to learn these the hard way. In terms of auditioning, I mean, it's just a lot of times they really just want to see you and who you are, your own personality. At least that's what I've found. Yes, there's a character, and yes, there's a story that, you know, you fit into. But ultimately, you know, it's how the actor fits into that story and how they best tell it. And, you know, from what I found, usually, you know, the actor who gets it is the one who, you know, is right for the story and right for the storytelling and the tone and the mood of the piece. But in terms of auditioning, I mean, just really be relaxed, really be focused on your craft and focused on yourself and not worry about other people and, you know, what other guys and girls in the room are doing. Just really, you know, just go for it, basically.
Well, and you do voiceover work, and I'm sure, like myself, you see auditions come down where they say they want you to sound like.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people get hung up in that is then they try to mimic and sound like, when in fact that's not what that meant at all.
Completely.
They meant have this type of mindset, this type of feel, but put your own signature on it. And I think that's where people can fail in auditions when they forget to be them.
Totally.
Like you just said.
Totally.
So, tell us more about your secret life.
My secret life or the secret life?
Oh, the secret life, yes. The secret life of you on the show.
So I was a series regular on a show on ABC Family that ran for 5 seasons, Secret Life of the American Teenager, not My Secret Life.
Oh, okay.
That might be a reality show, and, you know.
That's coming out soon to a theater near you.
Yeah, no.
So were you troubled as this character role also, or were things more balanced for you in this series?
Yeah. When I first, characters was Ethan on the show, and when Ethan first appeared in the world of Secret Life, mm-hmm. he was actually in a lawyer's office. For sending pictures, how do I put this, explicit pictures of his girlfriend.
You weren't sexting, were you?
No, it was something like that.
Okay.
The character was, not me.
Right.
Yeah.
I noticed you put all these disclaimers so people know, this was the role, this is me.
Well, because you prefaced it like, you know, your secret life. I'm like, well, let's just, you know,
yes.
The show.
Exactly. Your secret life on the show of The Secret Life.
Yeah. But no, he was in a bit of trouble and he was stealing shoes and knives and just kind of a troublemaker, really, you know, because he wanted attention and was trying to get people to notice him and that kind of thing. So his foster mother, Margaret, who was wonderful to work with on the show, kind of bailed him out a little bit and is like, all right, you know, you can't be stealing things anymore, but, you know, you need to go to school and be a good kid. And so that was kind of Ethan's arc, you know, over the course of the show, he kind of let go of some of that stuff and really warmed up a lot.
So do you find that people compare you to other teen heartthrobs of different eras? Have you had those comparisons made at this point in your career yet?
Yeah, sometimes. Ooh. Some people, Matthew Broderick,
okay,
from Ferris Bueller's Day Off, which was awesome. Some people actually say Tom Cruise.
Really?
Which is great. Yeah, I'll take that all day long.
Absolutely. I mean, all the way to the bank, in fact.
Yes, he's had a heck of a career.
Yes, he has.
Andrew Garfield, sometimes people say, from Spider-Man, The Amazing Spider-Man, that's out with Emma Stone and Social Network.
Right.
Which I'd love to do a film like.
Here's the early Matthew. Could you do some face hair real quick?
And I need to morph
you two together. He's had a brilliant career and married a lovely wife, so
Who
knows what the future holds for you. And so when you read some of these things that people publish about you, do you ever go, that's not really true, or that's not really me? What's the real you?
The real me?
Mm-hmm.
Man, I don't know.
You don't know.
I know.
Okay.
I play
the part of the real me, but
I love to have fun. Love music. Mm-hmm. Love a lot of different bands. You know, I love great films.
Football.
Football completely, man. The playoffs.
So I've heard. Yes.
Yeah, and you know, love spending time with my family. Really. Those are kind of major points, I guess.
We have another question from one of our actors, each other's.
Yes, question from Los Angeles, California. Is any roles that you'd like to play?
Roles I'd like to play.
Now's the time to get it out there.
Yeah, let's see, you know.
Let's start with roles you'd like to play for television, and then we'll
for television?
For film. What television role would you like as a role that would, I want to get into?
You know, I've been starting to watch Breaking Bad, actually, over the Christmas holiday.
That's so Disney of you.
It's so Disney of me,
Breaking Bad.
Heisenberg and the whole deal.
Right.
Why don't you
just go Game of Thrones? Go all over here.
Yeah, completely.
Okay.
But no, I was watching Aaron Paul's role on that. And,
right.
As an actor, you know, I'm always looking there we go.
Nice.
Aaron Paul in the back there.
Okay.
And, you know, in a few years, that'd be the kind of role that I'd love to try out for, you know, or take a shot at, that kind of thing, on television.
And for film?
Film, let's see, you know. There was a wonderful role that Leonardo DiCaprio did before Titanic in a film called Basketball Diaries.
Okay.
And he played this kid who was kind of lost and really came off the tracks in a lot of ways in his life. And he was so phenomenal in that. That's a kind of role that I'd love to do. He was actually a drug addict in that.
Really?
Yeah, and so, you know, it's just roles like that, you know, as an actor always.
And here's Leo in the role of the Basketball Diaries.
Intense and, you know.
Yeah, he has that look in his eye.
Yeah.
Yes. Another question from an actor's E-Chatter. Boy, you're blowing up the E-Chatters today.
Right. So some of the questions include great advice from such a young man.
Oh, wow.
Nice.
Another chatter says, are you still in school?
I'm 18. I guess I can make that public.
So you
knowledge.
Do have your driver's license
I
now,
do have my driver's
license.
You can't
legally go to those cocktail parties yet.
No, not legally.
Okay. Do your parents come with you when you go to the celebrity cocktail events?
No, actually. Well,
your manager agent?
Yeah, it's them. Or,
trusted person?
Yeah, and it's they kind of trust me to, they're like, all right, you know. No pictures of you with a cup of scotch or a shot of scotch or anything
cup
like
of
that.
Scotch. He went for the whole bottle. We'll be back with more with Michael Grant and Actors Eat Chat live from Hollywood. I'm Kurt Kelly.
Hey everyone, I am Judith Jones. If you are looking for photographs, which a lot of you are, let's face it, we need photographs every day. Actors, models, even if you're just, you know, the milkman, you need photographs, okay? You need to look good. And if you want to look good, you've only got one man to go to, and that's John Michael Ferrari. You see, I needed to look good. So I went to John, and he basically took me to the most beautiful place in LA and took these wonderful photographs of me. And I really didn't even recognize myself because I just looked, well, let's just face it, I looked stunning. So if you want to look stunning like myself in those photographs, go to him. He will make you look beautiful. If you're pretty, he'll make you look prettier. If you're not pretty, he'll make you look pretty. John Michael Ferrari. That's all you need to know. So go to imagesbyferrari.com. That's the website, imagesbyferrari.com. And you can check out all his photography and you can contact him there. You can look at a picture of me. He directed me, because if you need direction, which, hello, I do, he directs you too. So go and check that out, imagesbyferrari.com. You'll love it. You'll look great. Check it out. Bye, everyone.
Give me a frame. Oh, hi. Welcome back to Actors Eat Chat Live from Hollywood. We're just strategizing what we're going to tell you about in a moment, which would be go to the Actors Reporter site and click on the Actors Reporter discount link. And when you see those discounts, those are the people who have supported the show over the last 6 years for nearly 2,000 celebrity guests. But who's counting? And when you type in Actors Reporter in their site, you'll get special discounts on the services they provide, like bringing you this show live from Hollywood Monday through Friday at 10 in the morning. Put it on your calendar and make sure you like the page you're watching this on, please, because we want to know we did something you like today. Why are you chuckling about this?
Delivery's great.
Oh, thanks. Thank you for that critique.
He's the voice of experience.
Yes, let me tell me now. So, I want to know more about your secret life. What was one of your favorite scenes in the series? Is this it?
Definitely. This was a great scene, actually. It was towards the end of the show.
Mm-hmm.
Ricky, played by Darren Kagasoff.
We're looking over your shoulder right now.
Yeah, we're looking
now,
over
we?
My shoulder.
Okay, there
There's
we
me.
Are.
There we
are. Yeah, you look like that guy.
Yeah. Yeah, I was trying to go out with my girlfriend and party it up, and Ricky's telling me, you know, you got to take your time, man.
Oh, is this a scene I watched this morning at 5 o'clock when my eyes were hardly open and you were trying to decide whose house you were going to go to? Something like that. I guess you have to watch the scene. Can you find the scene on your website if somebody wants to catch this clip if they've missed it before?
I think it's on YouTube as well.
Okay, so just Google him.
Yeah,
you will find him. He'll be somewhere at a web browser near you. So you also were in, was it Criminal Minds?
Yeah, Criminal Minds.
Tell me more about Criminal Minds. What was that like?
Criminal Minds was awesome. I got to work with...
Who's this? Is this the girl you were trying to...
No. That's Shailene Woodley, awesome actress, mm-hmm. Who was in The Descendants with George Clooney,
mm-hmm.
and has a bunch of cool projects coming out now, Divergent and The Fault in Our Stars, which are going to be coming up later in the year, I think.
Right.
But she was awesome to work with, so warm and welcoming, and really kind of extended a metaphorical hand, so to speak.
Metaphorical.
Okay.
We're going back to some family stuff again here. Okay, getting into the mom and dad family tree. So, Criminal Minds.
Yes.
How was that experience?
It was awesome. Yeah,
wow, look at the cast.
Yeah, I worked with the two guys in the front there, Thomas Gibson and Joe Mantegna.
Joe, I understand, is phenomenal to work with.
Yeah, he's great. I mean, he's worked so much.
Is he one of these experts that kind of take you under the wing and goes,
yeah, he was actually.
Let me share this with you.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, it was cool. You know, before the scene, we were shooting at someone's house,
mm-hmm.
way up in, I think it was like Eagle Rock, which is like Pasadena, for those who aren't familiar with. California. Yeah,
yes.
It's
here
about,
in SoCal.
I'll make it easy. Like 40, maybe 45 minutes outside of LA or outside of downtown.
Okay. Yeah, in rush hour, yeah. It could actually be a week back a lot.
Yeah. But anyway, it's off the point. No, we were shooting at someone's house up there, and he was great. You know, we had a couple scenes together, and you know, we were reading them before we would go to shoot. He was like, you know, here, try this or try that, or you know, kind of just asking little acting questions just to make sure we were really working together in the moment and keeping it real and alive and that kind of thing. So he was awesome.
Do you find that there are some people who can memorize their lines and know them after one read?
Yeah.
Do you have to rehearse your lines a lot? Is it easy for you to remember them?
I do. I have to rehearse a lot. Well, I mean, it depends. I mean, sometimes you'll kind of get in the groove. It depends on the script.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if there's big chunks of dialogue that you have to memorize, then sometimes I just have to sit there and just go over it and put in the man hours to make sure I know it and internalize it and that kind of thing. sometimes if it's just kind of a back and forth scene, you know, with two people, like kind of what we're doing
right
now, it'll come easier, and you know, only need a couple times to be able to do it off the page.
Well, especially if it's more improv and living and dying by the script, unlike, you know, some scenarios you go into if you miss one word.
Yeah.
You said ah, and it was the. Okay,
yeah.
Yes, I understand. Yeah. Let me try that again for the 19th time.
Yeah.
So when you are doing a show like Criminal Minds and then you switch to a show like Brooklyn 99, how's the mindset changing for you?
It's a lot, actually. It's a lot different. You know, Brooklyn Nine-Nine, working with Andy Samberg and Andre Brower and, you know, the awesome cast that they have, it's very different. You know, there's a lot of room for improv, whereas Criminal Minds, it's very scripted. You know, there's a killer.
Which is a perfect example of both switching, where it's not so rigid.
Yeah, completely.
Was there a lot of comedy with Andy? And who else was in these scenes with you?
That's Andy. And he played my father, Deputy Police Commissioner Podolsky.
Yes.
Was his name. Was his character's name.
And who's the actor, do you recall?
I'd say it was Jim.
Jim. Hi, Jim. How are you? Yes. So that wasn't as rigid about doing all the lines.
Well,
they allowed a little improv?
What they would do, I mean, they basically, you know, there was definitely room for improv, but they'd want to get a couple takes, at least, you know, with the script, mm-hmm. you know, just to have options. There were a ton of options that they must have had in editing.
So in a scene like this, how much improv was allowed to happen?
You know, this was funny because we actually came back. This wasn't in the original shoot.
The
original week we shot, this was, but the other bit, running from the police, wasn't. They rewrote a bit and came back and shot it. And Andy was great. He kept finding little funny things with his sandal and, you know, running
and
down the sidewalk.
This?
That's Gina. She's in the office that she plays.
So do you have much chance to interact with the writers and the actors in a show like this while it's actually being developed so you can be part of the creative process? Or is it still pretty rigid that here's the script, play with its own?
Andy does. Andy is actually a producer on the show, mm-hmm. and he has a lot of, he works very closely with the writers and the directors. And
probably is one of the writers on the show, knowing Andy.
Yeah, probably by now, actually. He's probably writing episodes.
Right.
But he's very close with them, but he's really the only one. Andre Brower and the rest of the cast, at least to my knowledge, mm-hmm. really are just kind of, you know, don't really have the influence over character and story as much necessarily. It was awesome. There's a lot of room for improv, but, you know, obviously staying within the confines of the script. So.
And here is Andre.
Yeah, here's Andre.
How's he to act with?
He's awesome. I mean, he's an amazing actor. You know,
is he someone you learned a lot from?
Yeah, completely.
How so?
Yeah, he was, how so? Just how relaxed he was, how focused he was, you know.
His demeanor.
Yeah, completely. He was, you know, some people like to joke around and have fun and, maybe give off the air of not taking it so seriously, but he, you know, takes his comedy seriously.
Right.
And,
this is an art to him.
Yeah.
Tell
very
me
much.
About Children's Hospital.
Children's Hospital was a blast. I got to work with Rob Corddry and Megan Mullally and Aaron Hayes and a bunch of, there they are.
Yeah.
It was a young billionaire.
You were a young billionaire.
I was,
nice.
Yeah, this, a 17-year-old.
You kind of have a Bill Gates look about you. A little.
Bill Gates.
Just kidding.
All right.
Well, you said young billionaire.
Yeah, young billionaire, yeah.
That's right. I forgot you're an Apple guy. I'm sorry. Who was that other guy?
Steve Jobs.
Yeah, that guy.
Yeah, that guy.
See, you can tell I use Apple a lot. So how was it acting with this cast different from the other stuff
they
you've
were,
done?
They were incredible. This was actually, I think, probably the most, you know, quote-unquote fun I've had working on a show because everything was so wide open.
Really?
Yeah, completely.
Was there more ad-libbing in this or not?
Oh, a lot. I mean, like this scene we're watching here was everyone stayed pretty much true to script, but other mm-hmm. scenes, Megan Mullally, dressed as the old lady with the funky glasses there.
The fish bowls.
Yeah, like this. What she's doing here wasn't exactly scripted. Like, it wasn't scripted that she, like, gets
right in your face?
Yeah, gets in my face and does crazy stuff.
Okay.
She was awesome. Actually, in one scene, she stuck her leg out. It was like at an office, you know, like a nurse's station. And so I was... passing by, and she just
like trying to almost trip.
Like trying to trip me, but she like stuck her entire leg like over the desk or so, just.
Wow.
And but yeah, she would. It was crazy. I mean, just so in the moment and spontaneous. And
do you ever find that when you're in a role like that and you've got the script memorized and here's what we're supposed to do, when somebody throws you a curveball, are you easy to adapt, or does it kind of for a minute shock you?
The hardest part is keeping a straight face, especially when it's in comedy, because those people are so funny and they're just so, just like I said, in the moment and spontaneous and just no 10 steps ahead of time, you know, what they're going to do. But yeah, it's just about staying in character and staying committed to the role and circumstances that are in the script, and, you know, not allowing myself to kind of come out of the scene and watch myself, but rather just staying in it with the other actors.
So regardless of age,
yeah,
someone looks at what you've achieved already at age 18.
Yeah.
And you know, just to get the age barrier out of the way, you know, looking at Roseanne Barr, who started her real success when she turned in her 40s, and many other people. Regardless of age, what advice would you have someone who's always thought about doing what you're doing, but hasn't had the courage to take the steps?
Oh, man. You know, who said it? The greatest thing we have to fear is fear itself, right? There's another one that I like. I think it's Ernest Hemingway. We are all very near greatness. What is it? Yeah, we are all very near greatness. One step and we are safe. Can we not take the leap? And that's the quote, a quote that he wrote. I have it on a card, actually, in my room that I look at from time to time. And basically, that's it. I mean, you know, just know what you want, and, you know, if it's something you want to do, and if maybe something you kind of want to do, or you know, you want to try, you know, go for it. I mean, you know, you got nothing to lose, really, by going and trying, and yeah, at least giving it a shot. I mean, that's kind of my view on it.
I think a lot of people don't always remember that some of the greatest teachers are failures.
Yeah, completely.
What did I do wrong? What do I need to do differently next time? Obviously, you've done a lot right that you won a People's Choice Award. How did that happen?
I didn't win a People's Choice Award. But I was up. The show was, went to the Teen Choice Awards.
The Teen Choice.
Teen Choice Awards.
Well, but the people chose you.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
That would be a People's Choice to choose you. How did it feel to have the teen peers say, you're the guy?
I mean, it was really cool. I was best show for Secret Life,
right?
Which was awesome. Oh, here I am with the co-star.
On the red carpet.
Yeah, on the red carpet, which was awesome. She was great, by the way.
Sierra Ramirez.
Yeah, Sierra Ramirez was phenomenal to work with.
So this was an award for both of you for the series?
Yeah, for the show, best summer show, basically. And it was awesome.
Was this your first major award on national television?
Yeah, completely. I'd never done a red carpet before in my life before that. So that was kind of...
How is it different from what you envision when you see it on television? Oh, here's what they do. To the reality of what really happens there.
All right, the reality of it is it's fun. Like, don't get me wrong. It's cool. And, like, there's, like, 20 guys behind a barrier, sometimes there's a gate or whatever,
right,
taking your picture, and everyone's flashing. They're like, all right, look here. It's very, it's kind of like, you almost wish it was more glamorous once you get there because you see so much about it, but it's kind of like, everyone's on a schedule, and it's like, all right, the show needs to start at 1, so let's, like, all right, everyone take your picture, then you do your interviews, then get in the show so we can stay on time.
Mm-hmm. But, So most award shows, candidly, as you see from watching them, never run on time. But we're going to run on time and be back in a moment with more of Actors E-Chat, live from Hollywood with Michael. I'm Kurt.
Over her long career, Nina Fosh appeared in classic films such as Spartacus, The Ten Commandments, and An American in Paris. She received an Academy Award nomination for her performance in Robert Wise's Executive Suite. In 1965, Nina Fosh arrived here at USC to begin teaching directing, and I was lucky enough to get into one of her first classes. Even as she continued acting in film and television, Nina's passion for teaching lasted for over 40 years. Her course was immensely popular because she developed her own unique style, drawing on her experiences studying with Lee Strasberg, Stella Adler, and Uta Hagen, and being directed by such icons as Vincent Minnelli, Stanley Kubrick, Cecil B. DeMille, and Otto Preminger. As I began directing, the tremendous value of her teachings became evident and how important it was to preserve them for future generations. We became close friends, and at a cinema department event, we ran into my former classmate, George Lucas, who invited us up to Skywalker Ranch, where we discussed creating a DVD of her course. He agreed to finance it, and on January 10th, 2002, we began taping an entire semester using a crew of USC film students. We filmed for 8 hours a week for 15 weeks, and this is the result.
Okay, so what are we going to do this semester?
Live from Hollywood, this is Actors eChat. Don't forget to go to the Actors Reporter site and click on the Actors discount code and see the people who have been bringing you this show over the last 5 years. And when you put in Actors Reporter on their website, magically you'll get a discount. So you, Michael Grant is with us today on Actors eChat, and you have been working on some new films aside from all your television and music endeavors. Tell me about them.
It was actually in Louisville all of November shooting the land of, I think you mentioned in the beginning, bourbon or something like that.
Yes,
bourbon
and whiskey. Yeah. Jack Daniel's country. So you were actually back home kind of doing
something.
How
did
it feel going back home from Hollywood to say, hey, all right, now I'm going to do my first film here?
It was cool. You know, it's weird because I've...
Had all your friends over on the set? Come on over, see me.
No, actually, no. But I'd never actually been that close to home getting to work on... You know,
how
a real
cool.
project, which
right.
was cool. But yeah, it was
and
great.
And what's this film about?
The film is called Produce, and it should be coming out in 2014, possibly 2015 at some of the film festivals, Sundance and that kind of
thing. So we may be seeing you at the American Film Market this coming year.
Yeah,
okay,
maybe.
Good.
But yeah, the film is called Produce, and it's actually a story centers around a young man with Down syndrome.
So it has nothing to do with melons?
No.
Okay.
Well, I mean...
Indirectly... Why is it called Produce?
Well, indirectly it does. All right, I'll tell you. Because the young man with Down syndrome, played by a wonderful boy who actually has Down syndrome...
In real life?
Yeah, in real life. Wow. David Sanctus, who was wonderful. He was actually a local hire there in Louisville, Kentucky.
Now, is this based on a true story? Or is it a dramatic flick?
I think it may have... The writer-director may have had some experience with it. Chris Dowling, who was awesome to work with. But to my knowledge, it's not based on a memoir or anything like that. But the young man with Down syndrome is nicknamed Produce in the film because he works at a grocery store. And one of the earlier scenes we see him in, there's Chris Dowling. There he is. Yeah. He knows all the fruits and veggies in the produce aisle. And so it's kind of a really cool, heartwarming thing. He goes up to customers, and everyone nicknames him Produce.
How nice.
Yeah, and so...
So is this a family film?
Yeah, very much a family film. There's a Produce and another character, Calvin, who's an ex-baseball player. And like the major leagues, he used to play Major League Baseball. Kind of form a bond and a friendship because Calvin, one of the characters, has... become an alcoholic and fallen on some hard times, and there he is, Chris Palaha.
Okay.
And it's a really awesome, heartwarming film, and I play another troubled kid in it.
You have a theme going on here. I'm troubled again.
Yeah, again.
How about your other films that you're working on? Because you have a couple others.
Yeah, there's
Are
another
you troubled
one.
In those also?
The other one, Zoe Gone, which should be coming out here in 2014.
Yes.
At some point. I kidnap a baby.
I would say there's some trouble there.
I mean, okay, but here's the thing.
Minor detail.
Here's the thing. He's not.
It's an Amber Alert.
No, he's a good kid. You know, he's just naive. He's naive. He's not like this dark, like twisted kind of kid. He's
You're
very
just
naive.
Borrowing the child.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, he gets corrupted by his stepbrother, his older brother, who loops him into this scam. He's like, listen, man, if we you know, take this kid, we can get a bunch of money and it'll be great. And I'm like, oh, okay. You know, like, I guess, you know, if you know, you take the fall for it.
I see.
So
he's kind of a gullible, nice guy who got in trouble.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
Would that be you in real life or not?
I don't think so.
Okay, good. Just checking. Michael Grant, our guest today, live in Hollywood on Actors eChat. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much.
And we'd like to remind you to go to his website on IMDb and check it out. And make sure you like
his website, which is Michael Grant. What is the number behind there? 14? There's 14 of you? Okay.
No, here it is.
And then on Twitter, yeah. It's Michael Grant at 617?
Yeah, that's my birthday, actually. That's okay. A fun fact, June 17th.
So you're a Gemini.
Yeah.
We'll have another conversation about that in a few minutes then when we get off the air. And don't forget to look him up on YouTube where you can find his musical performances as well as many of his acting performances and see and make sure you like each of his pages when you get to them and like his work and go see it. I'm Kurt Kelly, and we have one more Actors E-Chat question from Pepper.
Yes, cool. They have, if they wanted to be in a fan club, where would they find your fan club stuff?
So
fan
they can club. Hang your posters on the wall.
Wait, what's the question? Like a fan club?
Where do they find your fan club?
Man, I guess Twitter.
Twitter.
Yeah, Twitter.
They could go to Twitter and do you have a Facebook page? They could Facebook you?
Yeah, linked up to Facebook and all that kind of stuff.
So go find them on Twitter. Yeah. Just Google them and start a fan club for them. That's it. And whoever asks the question, you can now be the temporary president until he approves you. In the meantime, make sure you go to my site on IMDb. And again, please like the page and stop by and you can see and hear a lot of shows and stuff I've done over the years at KurtKelly.com, as well as go to the website that's Kurt Kelly on Facebook, and it's Kurt Kelly One. And again, on Twitter, at Kurt Kelly on Twitter, and tweet me, and I'll tweet you back. We'd like to thank you for joining our show today and everyone who's been joining us on Actors E-Chat Monday through Friday at 10 a.m. live from Hollywood. We've surpassed 5 million people. I think we're closer to 6, but who's counting? Make sure you go see all of today's show and share it with your friends on Actors E or ActorsEntertainment.com and put in the name of the talent, like Michael Grant, type, and then he'll pop up now until who knows. And on Actors Entertainment on IMDb, you can find us on the Internet Movie Database, where over 1,000 entertainment guests and celebrities and luminaries have been on Actors E. And follow us on Actors Entertainment on Twitter at Actors Entertain, and tweet us away. And don't forget to like us and join us on Facebook at Actors Entertainment fan page. And again, don't forget to like us. Would you like to hold a telly?
Yeah.
That's what a telly looks like. And Actors Reporter Animation won the Best Animation at the Telly Awards for Pepper J Productions and Now Media.
Wow.
And if you order before midnight, no, just kidding. I'd like to thank you for being on the show with us today.
Thank you so much.
I wish you continued success, and I'm sure we'll see you back here again someday soon. Thanks for joining us live from Hollywood on Actors E-Chat. I'm Kurt Kelly. We'll see you again soon. Thanks.
What's that? Actors E-Chat show? Happens to be my favorite. In the morning, I want nothing but a cup of coffee, a bottle of Kahlua, six naked girls. Wait, no, that's not right. Actors E-Chat Show.
Oh my gosh. Hey, big Hollywood starlet that just happens to be walking by.
Yes?
I'm not from around here, but I want to be an actress just like you. What do I need to know?
Kid, let me tell you. Whether you're a seasoned pro or a naive newbie like you, there's one thing you need to know. To get my first job, I lived in a slum, beat out 50 other girls to play a drunk bum. My first agent charged me 30%.
Thanks.
Working three jobs and I couldn't pay rent. But I'm an actor.
She's an actor.
A shark gnawed my leg on a B film in Sydney. To pay for the stitches, I sold my left kidney. I finally made a union, their rules were complex. Their piles of paperwork fogged up my specs. But I'm an actor.
She's an actor.
I'm an actor.
Rather disturbing, but what's the one thing I need to know?
Don't listen to the critics, don't follow all the tabs. Forget that sleazy photog and the agent that's got crabs. Go to Actors Reporter.
Actors Reporter.
ActorsReporter.com. Learn the tricks. The secrets without all the sweat. An info-packed one-stop shop. It's free.
JudgeReporter.com.
How can they help her?
Career cues, union news, makeup woes, advice from pros, insurance tips, choosing scripts, everything at your fingertips. Actors Reporter.
Actors Reporter.
Actors Reporter.com.
I just got a callback.
Gruber. Thanks for joining us on Actors E Live Chat Show. I'm just one of your Actors E hosts, but as you can see, I'm also the Actors E Live video editor, which means that I'm here, even when you don't see me. Actors E is here to chat with you Monday through Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, or Hollywood time, as I like to call it. Our guests include actors, directors, producers, writers, singers, comics, and others that are all in the entertainment industry. You can see previous shows at www.actorsentertainment.com and be sure to check out our guest index to find your favorite celebrities. See you next time. I'm working.